Yo hablo español con fluidez. Llevo más de 10 años estudiando el idioma, practicando el idioma, hablando con nativos y todo. But still I receive questions from people asking me, you know, Elise, why is Spanish so special to you? Why do you have such an intense, you know, relationship with it? Because I live such a large portion of my life in Spanish, whether it's, you know, even when I'm watching TV in English, I'll put Spanish subtitles on, constantly talking to my friends in Spanish-speaking countries, keeping up with current events. In Spanish-speaking countries and stuff like that. But still, when people ask me, "Hey, Elise, what's the reason that you love Spanish so much?" I have no, like, I don't know how to put that into one sentence. So therefore, I wanted to make a video. So this video is going to be a recollection of, you know, my favorite anecdotes or my favorite experiences that never would have happened if I didn't speak Spanish because I wouldn't have had access to them. So buckle in, it's gonna get real personal. I don't think I'm gonna cry. I remember I cried in that video where I reacted to my first video on YouTube speaking Spanish. This is not a crying video. To you guys' luck. I have no problem with crying. I think it's an emotional release. But before we start, I wanted to give a quick shout out to my friend Marissa, who has been doing a demographic survey on language learners that I think is really, really important and you guys should really participate. So really, there have only been two small studies done about who adult language learners are. The problem with both of these studies is that, you know, they were focused on hyperglots and conference attendees, which, you know, excludes a large portion of language learners, such as, you know, parents, low-income language learners, full-time professionals, things like that. So Marissa is helping to collect information on who language learners really are. So if you take the survey that I'm gonna leave down in the description, it's like 5 minutes, you can help contribute to it and make sure that people like you are represented. So this survey is for everyone, no matter how many or how few languages you speak, as long as you consider yourself a language learner. When the survey is finished, she's going to publish the results online so that, you know, textbooks, apps, language teachers, content developers, all these different things will know how to better cater to us. So I'm gonna leave the link down in the description. It will take literally 5 minutes or less, and go take it. So one of my first most precious memories of Spanish starts in high school when I was 14. At a bus stop with a girl named Perla. Perla was a girl at my bus stop who her family and her had just moved here from the Dominican Republic, so she barely spoke any English. I'm sure she felt like really nervous and weird to be here. I was nervous to enter high school because I was emo and ugly, so I can't even imagine her pain, you know. But at least I spoke the language, so I could still, you know, conduct myself pretty well. But she, I can't even imagine like the stress that comes with, you know, being, you know, entering a new school in a new country at the same time, you know? So anyways, we were at the same bus stop, and just to clarify to my international audience, yes, yellow school buses are a real thing in the United States, and, you know, schools, school districts are, you know, responsible for setting up certain points around the city or bus stops that kids can meet at so they can get picked up for school. I had little to no speaking experience, and, you know, for a long time, I would just try to build up the courage, and I would just watch her and her struggles on the bus because, like, our bus driver would be trying to communicate with her and, you know, trying to tell her, like, hey, when you get off the bus, don't cross in front, you need to cross through the back so you don't get hit by a car and things like that. And so, you know, my bus driver, she would always pull out Google Translate to tell her and stuff like that. And it was just, it was a painful situation to watch a lot of the time because, you know, Google Translate's not that good. So I tried to start having little conversations with her every day in Spanish. You know, there was like maybe 10 or 15 minutes before the bus came in the morning where you're kind of just standing around with people, you know, some of them just quietly standing there, some of them shooting the shit. And I was such a freak. I would like take an index card and I would write down like potential topics that I could talk to her about. And I was so specific with it that I would even write down, like, you know, even phrases that I could use. Sometimes full sentences. And I wouldn't read off it while I was talking to her because I'm not a psychopath. But I would like take the little index card and practice it on the way to the bus stop, you know, reading my little phrases out loud, you know, having a conversation with no one, just by myself to practice. It was so cringy, but like now I think about it, it's kind of cute. But before I left for the bus stop, I don't know if you guys know this, but my mom is fluent in Spanish. So I would be asking her things in the morning, like, because she's a girl and it's como estás, do you say como estos if you're talking to a boy? Like, I didn't understand how gender worked. I remember that was a really hard thing for me to grasp, but I would be like obsessing and like asking my mom all these questions in the morning just because I was so scared of like making mistakes. But we got to talking every day and we became good friends. I was very persistent, a tryhard. It must have been very embarrassing at some point, but it was cool. You know, sometimes even like her mom and her brother would come to the bus stop with her, so I got to speak to all three of them. But me and Perla, we would sit together in the morning and in the afternoon, and I remember she would tell me about like her life back in the DR. She talked about Chris Brown a lot, which I wasn't listening to Chris Brown at that time because of what he did to Riri, but I didn't know how to say that in Spanish, so I just left it alone. So I let her show me all her favorite Chris Brown songs. And, you know, she had, I remember she had this whole, like, photo album of Chris Brown on her phone. And I would be like, ¿tienes un grupo de pinturas En tu móvil, wow. Does that ever happen to anybody else where you remember like a specific mistake that you made talking to someone like so many years ago? Just saying pintura is not a word. It's foto, imagen. But it was fun, you know? We were having fun. I knew I was making a shit ton of mistakes, but I didn't care because you don't need to speak a language perfectly to communicate with someone and to have a moment with someone. And, you know, eventually I became like the de facto interpreter for her on the bus, so my bus driver didn't have to like whip out her phone to Google Translate whenever she had to communicate. And I don't remember what happened to her. I think maybe she was on a different bus next year, or we just didn't see each other as much at one point. But I still remember that experience because it's just an example of like a moment where you don't have to speak someone's language perfectly and be able to communicate 100% clearly to have a good time. And that's what we did. We had a good time. 14-year-olds, one emo, one Dominican. United. So moving on, fast forward like 5 years, I want to say. I know these are like very far from each other. So 2019, when I was in Mexico, I was working at a bilingual preschool. I was living with just a regular host family in a part of Mexico City called Tlalpan. It's kind of like a suburb, but not the US type of suburbs with like the weird and identical houses, just like, you know, a nice residential area. So my host mom was like the director of the school, and that's why I was staying with them because it was like an exchange. And then there was also a host dad named Antonio. So my host dad, Antonio, he showed me how to get to the preschool every morning with public transport, and he showed me how to get there with la combi. Sí, la pinche combi. For people who have no idea what the combi is, it's basically like these little green vans that are always just buzzing around Mexico City that I'm pretty sure are the cheapest form of public transport. They're really efficient because they come like five at a time. They're like constantly arriving because I'm pretty sure they're independently contracted. So it's not like the United States where if you miss your bus or your subway or your train, you have to wait like 15 to 30 minutes for another one. They're like constantly coming. These vans are not huge. They're probably designed to fit like, what, 10 people inside, but that's not fucking happening. There will literally be anywhere from like 15 to 20 people inside of these things because, you know, depending on the model of the combi, because, you know, you have to realize that these are not all the same model. Some of them could be like more modern and industrial, and some of them are like the original combis from the 70s that are like clunkers basically. So you're like squished between two people, your legs are all bunched up because there's like a whole row of people in front of you, somebody's Tio Alberto's on your lap. It's a great time. It's the best thing ever. And one thing that I really enjoyed while using the combi was the payment process. I know this sounds so weird. I'm getting there, I promise. So you can either pay when you get on or when you get off, but depending on where you're sitting, you either, you know, pass it to someone who passes it to the driver in the front, or you are the person that receives people's money to pass it to the driver behind you. Can we just appreciate for a second that those drivers can literally navigate the crazy animal that is Mexico City while like calculating in their head and, you know, physically reaching back there every 5 seconds to give the change? I had a lot of admiration for those guys. So if you're giving your money to the person to pass it to the driver, you say, "Me lo pasas, por favor," and then they pass it back to the driver. And when the driver took it, you would have to yell your destination so that they could like calculate the end point and beginning point, and they would know how much change to give you. Pass it to the person, the driver gets the change, passes it back to them, they pass it back to me. Gracias, put it back in my pocket, and everyone just keeps existing in peace. And no one really talks to each other on the combi. It's not like in the United States where, you know, I think if you're in the United States and you were that squished up with a stranger, you would feel obligated to say something. But no! Everybody's just fucking vibing there in our sardine can, you know? Even though people don't talk on the combi, there's still like a certain etiquette. So when a person flags it down and they run up, open the door, get on, whenever like the combi would pick up a person, they would always say buenas when they would get on. They'd be like buenas, and then everybody say buenas. And then there's the whole payment thing, which is nice because it's like everyone's helping each other, just, you know, common care. And I remember whenever I was trying to get off, like when you're trying to get off the combi, there's no button, there's no pull string, there's no nothing. You literally just have to yell like, "Hey, let me off." So you'd be like, "Bajan, por favor." But the problem was I had such a mousy voice. I was still very shy, so I would never raise my voice enough. I'd be like, "Bajan, por favor." Nobody heard that. The person next to me barely even heard that. But, you know, someone would inevitably always, you know, speak up in my favor and be like, "Bajan." So I really appreciated that. And then when you get off, you say goodbye to everyone, say buen día, and everybody just continues their day. However, my favorite part of using the combi was being just in the middle of the work culture. Because like I said, when I would get on in the mornings, nobody was really talking. And I'm pretty sure it was because it was commute time. Like, everybody's tired as shit. Oh my god. And some people, like, you could tell they were rushed in the morning. They would be eating their breakfast in the fucking combi. They're stinking up that whole joint with all types of yummy ass smells, like huevito con salchicha and chilaquiles, whatever. Or like sometimes you would see a person dressed up really snazzy with like a black binder, and you're like, you just know that they're on the way to like an important interview or something like that. So if you're a people watcher or you love to observe strangers, What better place to do it than the combi, where, you know, personal space doesn't exist and you have nothing better to do than look at a bunch of strangers? So it was all, like, super meaningful to me when I was there because, you know, observing the payment system, adopting that behavior, adopting the little courtesies that people would extend to each other, like the me lo pasas por favor, the buenas, everything. Because it allowed me to, like, establish a certain independence when I was there. There are so many different types of public transport in Mexico City, like the Metrobus, subway, tren ligero, taxis. I could have even taken Uber because, you know, they're a lot cheaper in Mexico. But I just loved taking the combi because it made me feel close to the people actually living there, you know? Like, feeling like a part of everyday processes and normality, you know, brings you so much closer with the city than, you know, if you're just kind of looking at it kind of like a visitor. However, plot twist, come to find out, when I got back to the United States, I Googled it and I found out that the combi is like the most dangerous form of transportation in Mexico City. Motherfuckers be hijacking those things, stopping them, and like robbing everybody on there. I saw a news story about like a combi driver that on video took a cocaine bump while he was driving, and I was like, oh, I think even shootings. But anyway, it just made me laugh so hard because, you know, I just think of myself in the combi all like blissfully naive, like, oh, I'm part of something. Just happily, you know, feeling included. And I never even thought to ask anybody, you know, like, what's up with the combi? And I remember when I first started working at the preschool, one of the ladies one morning, she asked me, like, ¿cómo llegaste? And I told her that I had come with the combi. And she looked so shocked. She was like, ¿viniste con la combi? And I was like, yes, fucking what? What? I didn't understand why it was such a big deal. But she never even told me. She was just like, oh, okay. And it just makes me think, like, why did my host dad put me in that situation? What's the mental process there when you're receiving a person from a foreign country who's never been in your country before? You're like, I'm gonna put this bitch on hard mode. She's going on the combi. Like, why did he put me in such a potentially threatening situation? Why was that his first choice? But I'm glad he did it because, you know, it immersed me in Mexico City work culture, commute culture, and it gave me, you know, so many good memories of just, you know, watching the city pass by. Combi, I love you. So those are my two most precious anecdotes that never would have happened if I didn't learn Spanish. If I never mustered up the courage to go talk to Perla, I think I would have taken a lot more time to, you know, develop speaking confidence, because that was kind of like the tipping point where I felt like, hey, I can do this. And then, you know, 4 years down the line, you know, I felt confident enough in my Spanish to go to Mexico City, where I got so much hands-on experience in the Spanish-speaking world. Because, you know, what better city to get that experience than the largest Spanish-speaking city in the entire world? So my point is, it's good to reflect not just on progress that you make in a language, but the opportunities that you get because of, you know, that language, and really savoring them in the moment, because that's what we're doing all this for, right? To have personal human connection. That's what's gonna make you feel the proudest after, you know, 2, 5, 10, 15 years of learning a language. You know, I've been seriously, you know, pursuing Spanish for the last 6 or 7 years, and I've gotten to travel because of it. I've gotten to read high literature in the language. I've learned a lot more about Western history. I did research in the language, which I actually presented at a conference a couple weeks ago. All of this because, you know, Spanish fell into my path, and for that reason, it is the love of my life. So, thank you so much for listening to my story. I would love to know which language you guys feel this way about, whether it's Finnish, Azerbaijani. Which language is your eternal love and your best friend? So I hope everyone's well. If you want to keep up with my social media, it's Elise de Vega on everything. Yes, Elise Speaks on Instagram has died. It's not... Okay, let's unpack this for a second, because I just did that without telling anybody or warning anybody. My name on YouTube is going to stay Elise Speaks. It's just that I like my name. I like seeing my name wherever I can, so I claimed it on Instagram as well. So anyway, go keep up with me there, and I will see you guys real soon. Bye-bye.